Hello and welcome to this lesson, brought to you by BitMerge. In this lesson, we'll cover the basic ideas behind Turing machines. Turing machines are powerful devices with an interesting property. They're not physical devices, but rather abstract mathematical objects. They were developed by Alan Turing in 1936 while he was working on the Entscheidungsproblem, or decision problem. The decision problem is fundamental to logic. After having been around for some time, the problem was formalized by David Hilbert in 1928. The decision problem is concerned with the validity of propositions. It rains when it is raining is true, for example, and it rains when it is not raining is false. Specifically, Turing was interested in the question, what is computable? The machine developed by Turing can mathematically describe any operation any modern computer can perform, just by following a few simple rules. In fact, it's capable of describing infinitely many operations, though not every conceivable operation is possible on a Turing machine. Turing machines find applications in mathematics and computer science as powerful yet simple explanatory tools. Let's look at the basic parts of a Turing machine. One of the key components is a strip of tape called the tape or memory. The tape is infinite in length and divided into an infinite number of cells. Each cell holds a character or symbol which can be read or overwritten by the machine's read-write head. The alphabet of characters that can be represented on the tape is given the name capital Sigma. Our example machine in this lesson will use the characters 0 and 1. 0 and 1, then, are characters that are allowed to be written on the tape. There's another alphabet Turing machines use, which we call the tape alphabet, and represent with capital Gamma. It contains the 0 and 1 from Sigma, as well as a few special symbols used in computations. These symbols mark the start position, the end position, and a blank or unused cell. The portion of the tape enclosed by the start and end symbols make up the input. The read-write head is always positioned over exactly one cell and can read a symbol from that cell or write a new symbol in its place. The machine has the ability to move the tape one cell to the left or to the right at any time during operations in order to reposition the read-write head. It may also elect not to move at all during an operation. With this setup, the tape acts as both an input-output device and a storage medium for information. There's more that goes into the functioning of a Turing machine, like states and transition functions, which we'll explore in another video. The way Turing machines use this structure is the following. The input is written on the tape. The machine starts by reading the first symbol and writes a new symbol in its place, according to a set of instructions. The instructions also tell the machine which direction to move. The machine follows this read, write, move cycle over and over again, until it's told to halt. The string written on the tape at the end of all of this is the output, and the computation is complete. Turing machines are useful for several reasons. They gave us the first theoretical model for building actual computers. Though computers no longer use this model, instead preferring electrical and a few mechanical components, Turing machines are still used widely in computer science as models for computation. Algorithms for solving problems can be expressed in Turing machine languages, and Turing machine languages can even help with understanding how programming works. With a mathematical machine designed, a simple but important definition arises regarding computability. A number or function is said to be Turing computable if there is a Turing machine that can compute it. That means that Turing machines can tell us a lot about computation in general, in addition to being easy to build and manipulate mathematically. We can learn about the limits of computation using Turing machines in this way.